is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 5, Death Masks, Chapters 30, 31, and 32. In these final chapters of Book 5, Harry touched a coin. Guys.
I didn't care for that.
Whoops! Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, power and rain. Welcome to the show, everyone. I'm Natasha.
I'm RoShawn.
So I remember first reading this and I was very, as you put it, I did not care for it.
Yeah, not one bit.
This is not something I was excited about. What did you think of these last three? What did you think of this as like the big ending for this book?
It was pretty fucking good for a big ending of a book.
Cool.
It was... The chapters were pretty long because there was a lot they had to get resolved.
Mm-hmm.
But it was exciting. It didn't end how I thought it was going to end. It definitely didn't end how I thought it was going to end with that last little how do you do there at the end.
Right.
But yeah, it was really good. It was surprisingly emotional with the scene with Shiro. And then I laughed because he pulled a Sherlock. And he had mailed a letter 2 weeks ago that showed up while Harry was at the house. So that gave me a chuckle. Yeah, I really liked it.
Awesome. Yay. I'm glad. So, there's so much to cover here because these three, and I honestly, like, I could have broken this up a little bit more, I think, because they are really long chapters. Like
they are...
But
I don't know how we would have done it. Like, if we were going to break it up and we just did, say, 31 and 32 now and just did the last one for the last episode.
Mm-hmm.
I don't... Well, the chapter wouldn't have been long... Isn't enough, I think, for a whole podcast. But I guess we could have incorporated sort of a recap of the book.
Right.
But I still think this will be fine, too. Because a lot of what happens is action.
Mm-hmm.
And that never takes us long to talk about.
True,
these are
true,
really
true.
Action heavy, you know, and not so much plot moving forward heavy. You know what I mean?
Yes. Yeah, definitely. You are right. So, yeah, there's a couple things that happen here. Like, first of all...
I knew Marcone was going to be here. I wasn't sure what capacity, and I loved what he ended up being. And I also loved that reveal, too, about him at the end, too.
Yeah.
That was really good. Because I could not figure, and we'll get to it, I know, but I really couldn't figure out what he would want with the shroud,
mm-hmm.
right? Other than it is, you know, to sell. But didn't that just seem like a lot of work for him to do? And who is he going to sell it to, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I loved it. It turned out to be something much more personal and vulnerable. It was really good.
Yeah, this is the thing that Harry had sort of seen in the soul gaze, that he had a deep secret.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, obviously right. He didn't see what that was.
Yeah, and for a man like Marcone, the secret could literally be anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it's
he's
true.
Probably, he's got a million secrets. And you would think it would be something much more in line with what we know about him, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some particular murder that, you know, has haunted him where he can't let the world know he did or something like that. But mm-hmm. No, it turns out to be this little girl or his daughter. I'm assuming. Did they ever say it's his daughter?
They never say that.
So I'm not sure who she is to him. But this young woman who is in a coma is his dark secret
mm-hmm.
that he can't. And someone like him, the world can't know because that's be a way like that's leverage on him. You know, it's a weak spot.
Mm-hmm.
It's good stuff, man.
It's true. All right. So we start off chapter 30. Is it 30? Yes.
31.
30, and 31. Right. And they are heading to the airport. And you had been wondering, why the hell is he going to the airport last episode?
Well, yeah, we knew that the thing was going to go down at the airport. So I knew why he was going. But I don't think I knew what was going to happen there. Like, I didn't know what Susan, I'm not Susan, God. I didn't know what Karen was up to.
Mm-hmm.
Like, her thing was super secret.
Well, you said, you had said why, because you knew what they were going to do, but as far as doing it at the airport to spread it further, that was like as far as you got.
Oh,
and you didn't
really
get like the whole.
I thought you said when you didn't know why they were going to the airport, I thought you meant Harry and them, but you meant
Nicodemus. Oh, no, I meant Nicodemus, yeah.
Yeah, no, I didn't know what the fuck they were going to the airport for.
Mm-hmm. And it turns out that, you know, we actually got told this by Father Forthill, but I had forgotten it by this point when I first read it, that he gets a power up from inflicting suffering on as many people as possible. So imagine spreading a plague to potentially millions of people, what kind of horror show he would be to deal with by then.
Yeah. Yeah. And he's got, when they asked Nicodemus later why he's doing it, because he had made some offhand remark when he had Harry about bringing the apocalypse.
Mm-hmm.
But then he goes into a little bit more scary detail about what it is he's hoping to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just the death of hope.
Yep.
It's not just the power that he's going to get from the suffering, but that once people are broken down, then they become, I guess, easier to bring over to his side, easier to control. It just, it's pretty dark, guys.
Yeah, as you know, a person that's been really struggling with the idea of hope over the past couple of years, I definitely felt personally attacked by this.
Were you triggered?
Nicodemus. A little bit. He's like, yeah, you want to come over to my side? And I'm like, a little. Don't be like this.
Right. You guys seem to be winning. Yeah. I do like being on a winning team.
Right. So they get there and Harry, and he's like chilling as they describe the kinds of body armor / armor that they have on.
Michael is wearing a cape. I know he calls it a cloak, but that's a fucking cape and he knows it.
You do. Michael is old school.
He's like chainmail.
Yep. And Harry notices fucking Rudolph is like right there outside of the car, outside of Michael's truck. And he has to call Murphy and get her to kind of call in a bomb threat.
Yeah, no big deal.
You know, whatever.
It's only like a felony. What? You know, her whole career would be completely tanked immediately. But yeah, no big deal. Small favor.
Right.
Between friends. Not asking too much.
That's funny, because one of the books is called Small Favor.
Is it?
Yeah.
I can only begin to imagine what is going on in there.
So they managed to get the place evacuated by doing that. And this assures them that whoever's remains inside is going to be a bad guy.
Right, right.
Which, you know, is important since Sonya has a fucking Kalashnikov.
Yeah, how about that? You know what I thought was really good, too, about this thing about the bomb threat? Is that Harry, at first, is against it. And he's like, having the police around and all these people will force the Denarians to keep a low profile.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael has to be like, yeah, no.
Yeah, that they don't work like that, buddy.
But he does say, Michael does say, most supernatural creatures will hesitate before killing a police officer, a mortal police officer, which I thought was really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes on to say, but Nicodemus is not that dude. And he will totally kill everybody and use hostages to his advantage. But this idea that supernatural creatures won't kill a mortal cop. I'm assuming for the same reason gangsters often won't kill police officers, because they just don't want that kind of heat on them. Mm-hmm. I thought was just really interesting, because you don't think of... And I feel like that's something that may have come up in one of the earlier books. I don't know if it did specifically, but it feels like something that would have come up early on when Harry is first dealing with, you know, vampires or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it did too, but I can't think of a specific.
Yeah, because it seems like something that would have come up talking about Bianca, you know, like something she would say, or, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't remember if it did or not. So when it happens here, I was just like, huh, damn.
Right.
Police officers just getting passes everywhere.
Yeah. And like the thing is here that even if, like, the one other way that this could have worked out with them getting help from the authorities would be if special investigations was on it, because they have some experience with the spooky
right.
side of things,
right?
But they're not allowed on this case. So
yep.
Yeah, no, nothing doing. So they go into there's this amazing moment where Michael is saying that he can tell Nicodemus is nearby. And he asks Sonya if he can feel it. And Sonya says that there's a smell of mildew and the air
yeah.
feels greasy. And Harry's
yeah.
like, there is a Pizza Hut stand about 15 feet away.
Yeah, he's like, it's like sour milk and rotted meat and greasy.
Yep. Harry's like, well. And they try and, you know, stop and think, where is a place that they would go if they were a megalomaniacal demon psychopath? And they realize
I love this
chapel.
Yeah. I love that it's Sonya, too, who says it.
Yeah, that's true.
Because he doesn't, you know, I don't want to say he's more, you know, he's not that he's in a background, but he's, you know, he's quieter. And Michael does most of the talking. Harry does all the talking. But they're, like, thinking about, where would I go if I were a terrible demon collaborating terrorist?
Mm-hmm.
And he's just like, the chapel. And I like that they both just go, the chapel. Like, it makes perfect sense to everybody immediately.
Yep. Yeah, Sonya's like, yeah, where would you go? Well, guess who would know? The guy who was one. So they get there, and it
is
awful. Horrifying.
Yeah.
The walls have been painted with all kinds of symbols in blood.
Mm-hmm.
They have to fight their way through a bunch of tongueless dudes.
Yeah. At one point, Michael just fucking slashes through a metal door
mm-hmm.
to get to the guy that's shooting at them on the other side.
Pretty awesome, to
and
be honest.
And he's like, holy fuck.
And Shiro is there up on this, like, altar. And Harry kind of cracks.
Yeah, this is what's really sad. It's so gruesome. And, I mean, like, he describes it. I don't really want to go into it, but it's pretty bad.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, he's been cut up the way Gaston and the real Father Vincent
mm-hmm.
were. Everything that's broken, it could be broken. There's, like, one eye that's gone.
Yeah.
And Harry is fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
And of course he is, because there's a tremendous amount of guilt there, because Shiro literally sacrificed himself for
mm-hmm.
Harry. That's a lot.
And Harry just keeps on repeating how you wouldn't think there'd be this much blood. He wasn't a mm-hmm. big person. I mean, I knew him. He was small.
Yeah.
You would just never think there'd be so much blood. And he keeps, like, repeating this.
Yeah.
I liked that moment a lot. Just like,
yeah, it was hard
seizing on this weird thing, because that feels super true.
Mm-hmm. It does. Yeah, that kind of when you're in that sort of disbelief,
mm-hmm.
and it's things that you're looking at just don't add up to you.
Yeah,
because they're just too horrible to make sense. This moment really felt like that. And there, Michael's kind of trying to be like, "All right, well, we have to go now. They already did the spell."
Mm-hmm.
We have to go. We're probably, you know, already infected.
Yeah. Yeah, and Harry is standing there kind of feeling hopeless because of the fact that they already did it. Well, whatever. mm-hmm. like kind of, we can't stop it now, you know, like, and then Shiro coughs and Harry almost screams. He is startled.
Yeah, I was also startled.
Right?
It's Shiro just is like, I was getting tired waiting for you.
Yes. I love that. It fucking took you long enough. Jesus Christ. I'm dying over here. Literally. So it turns out that there is this thing called the Barabbas curse. And it is linked with the noose that Nicodemus wears around his neck.
Mm-hmm.
He gets to choose one person per year whose death cannot be avoided or circumvented in any way.
Right.
And the knights can choose to take that curse upon themselves if they choose to. And he chose Harry for it. And Shiro was like, nah. And took it himself.
Right.
So not only did Shiro sacrifice himself to release Harry physically, but there was a curse that he also sacrificed himself to save Harry from. Like, you know, he just did extra.
Yeah. Now he says, at one point, is this when Harry thinks about the entropy curse?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what that was.
Right.
Okay. And I'm trying to remember the sequence of events. So after the entropy curse, that's when Shiro, let me see, how does that work? The entropy curse attacks him and Susan.
On their way into his apartment, he puts the wards up.
Right.
It's banging against the wards until the wards go down in the morning. And by then, Shiro's like well within their grasp.
Got you. Okay. Yeah. All right. I like the little background story about Barabbas too. I'm assuming it's true. I mean, I don't remember the details from when I went to church.
Yeah. Let me look into this actually, now that you say that, because
is it Barabbas? It feels like if he's going to include it, that it probably is how it's represented. And that he's saying is that under the Romans, the Jews could pick one condemned prisoner a year to be pardoned.
Mm-hmm.
And that instead of what it's implied here is instead of it's not implied, it says mm-hmm. that they didn't choose to save Jesus. They chose a man named Barabbas.
Right. Yeah, it's only like the Barabbas curse. Oh, here it is. It's hidden from spoilers. That's why. Because I was like, it's not saying anything here. Oh, but it's still not really saying anything. Never mind. There's an article on like the Dresden Files wiki, but it is barely an article. It doesn't have any like deep information about it. Like what we just said is more in depth than what is here. So thanks for nothing, wiki.
Sometimes they're really good, and then sometimes they're.
You know, not. I really shouldn't take for granted. Like these are all done by volunteer people. You know what I mean? But it is one of those things that I'm like, well, why do you even have it? Because all it says is like it's a curse associated with Nicodemus Arcleone's noose. It's first mentioned in Death Masks.
Okay, regular Wikipedia just says that he was mentioned in the accounts of the Passion of Christ, but that is not the same as being in the Bible.
Right.
I don't think. But that he is an insurrectionary held by the Roman governor at the same time as Jesus and whom Pilate freed at the Passover feast in Jerusalem while keeping Jesus a prisoner.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Okay.
But there's a... Let's see. According to all four canonical gospels, there was a prevailing Passover custom. Oh, okay. I guess it is in there. Ooh, Matthew refers to him only as a notorious prisoner.
Ew.
Mark and Luke refer to him as the one involved in a riot. Hmm. Anywho, Okay.
So one good thing comes from Shiro, you know, having appeared to have been dead, mm-hmm. which is that they talk freely in front of him about what their plans are because they think he's dead.
Which seems very sloppy. You can't take a second, take a pulse.
Right.
Seems really, really sloppy, but you know, whatever.
And it turns out that they have a plan B. They're going to go to a train and head towards another airport. And Harry, basically, Shiro dies after yeah. telling them this. And Harry is like, all right, let's go. I think I can tell him where to pick us up. And they're like, who? And he's like, our ride. And they're like, who? And he's like, I'm a wizard. I'm not telling you shit because I'm dramatic. And he just keeps walking without telling them anything until finally they get picked up by Marcone in his helicopter.
In his own private Coast Guard grade
yep.
helicopter.
Piloted by Mizgard.
Yeah, and I love that Shiro gives Harry, or Michael, I guess, gives Harry... Does Shiro give Harry the cane, or does Michael do it?
Shiro, yeah, tells Harry to hold on to it until he knows who to give it yeah. to.
So I can't wait to see what happens with that. And then, yeah, Marcone shows up, and Harry is just like, sure would be nice if the Ride of the Valkyries was playing. And she has it. She like flips a couple switches and there it is.
She's like, yeah, I can do that. All right.
Which should be the music for this episode.
Right. I love it so much. So it turns out that this thing has a rescue winch. And that in order to get on the train, they need yeah. to go down on that.
Because this is apparently now a blockbuster summer movie. Right? Action movie. And they're going to Tom Cruise themselves to the train.
Yep.
Because in every movie he makes, he has to be like flying out of a helicopter for some reason in all his movies.
Or a jet.
Something, you know, right? Anything. He's always swinging in the air. I don't know why that is.
You really make it sound less awesome when you say it like that.
Don't care for him in his action movies. It's so stupid.
It is stupid. That's fair. You're 100% right.
I just saw a trailer. I guess there's a new Mission Impossible, so I saw a trailer for it when I went to see Black Panther. And sure enough, this motherfucker is swinging outside of a jet or something.
Oh my God.
In this newest movie. Like, anyway, Tom Cruise, I can't wait. Ew.
Yeah, I've never been a big fan of his. Mm.
I thought he was super cute when I was like 8.
Yeah, my mom always thought he was so hot and I didn't see it at all. But he's just got a sharp face and I tend to not go for guys like that. Anyway. So, yeah, when he tells Harry, like, we're going down on that winch, he's like, what?
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Michael's like, yeah, all right.
Michael is about it.
Yeah.
He's so fucking gangster. I love it so much. Also, Marcone also doesn't seem to have any trouble.
No, yeah. Sonya got, like, is also a little worried. He's
on and shit.
Marcone is not to be fucked with at all. Like, I really enjoy him so much because he could easily just be some fat cat gangster. And instead, he is dangerous. Like, yeah. On every possible level that a human being can be dangerous, he is. And it makes me really uncomfortable, but also a little bit aroused.
It's a little hot, right? A little bit, yeah. I mean, not that I'd go for that sort of, you know, murderous type of individual. But if that were the thing that I was into, yeah, he would be on the list. I like, too, the little back and forth he has with Harry about the shroud.
Right.
And Harry wants to know what he want with it. And Marcone is just like, I can't do business if the city's dead.
Yep. And Harry's just like, yeah, I feel like that's not all it is. And he's like, well, I don't really give a fuck if you care, if you think that's what it is. And then he's like, oh, we're going to go ahead and, you know, fight them. And you can just like wait for us on the helicopter. Marcone's like, yeah, that's not how this is going to happen. Harry tries to tell him how it's going to be. And Marcone is like, you know, this is my helicopter, right? Right? I could just turn this shit around.
We can go right. We can. I'll turn this car right around.
Yep. If you don't listen to your father.
Harry calls him a disease. What did he say?
You suck diseased moose wang.
And Marcone kind of like chuckles.
He says, how colorful. That's a great response. How colorful. Yes.
So they fucking end up on top of a moving fucking freight train. Because, yep, again, this is all going up to like 11 all of a sudden. And I feel like as soon as they get there, there's a problem.
Shit starts to pop off immediately.
Like there's a, you know, they all land safely and they get into like their little crouchy, you know, field positions. Like, you know, Michael's leading and saying it's got the rear and it, you know, whatever. And as soon as they start moving, these things, which are never explained, right?
I don't think so. They're just guard animals.
They never come back to what the fuck these things are.
Because this is actually, there was something that that Susan mentioned when they rescue Harry. He steps on something when they're heading back to like the ladder to get up to the surface. And he's like, oh my God, what is that? And she's like, oh, I don't know. It was some kind of guard animal. Shiro killed it.
Oh, well, there you go.
So there are a few. Yeah.
This is terrible. And so we've had pretty disturbing descriptions of the Denarians.
Mm-hmm.
This was not any better. It's got four legs. It looks sort of like a cat, but it's got no fur. It's got a jaguar / wild boar face with both tusk and fang.
Oh, goody.
Yeah. And it's moving very fast.
I don't, like, there are a lot of things that I want to see on the big screen from these books, and these are not one of the things. I'm just not interested. I'm good. Thank you very much.
The only good thing about these things is that it seems like they can kill them pretty easily.
Right, yeah.
That was the only positive that comes out of this.
So then they have their big face-off with Nicodemus.
This was awful also.
Yeah, things just...
He is... you go ahead, go first.
Well, I was just going to say that Marcone is mystified because Michael starts to fight Nicodemus. And Marcone has, like, basically riddles him with bullets.
Mm-hmm.
And Nicodemus drops out of sight for a bit.
Yeah. Like, they describe the bullets practically tearing his body apart.
Yep.
You know, like, his chest explodes, and then part of his, like, abdomen is gone. And
yep.
And Marcone is like, he looks down for the body, which is always the worst.
Right.
And the body is not there.
And he's trying, like, when he saw Michael fighting him, he's like, well, he must, like, that sword can take care of him, right? And Harry's like, I don't think so. And Marcone's like, wait, hold on. If the sword can't kill him, why the fuck is he fighting him then? And Harry says, because it needs to be done.
Yeah.
And then Marcone's like, all right, so, you know what I think we should do, right? And Harry's like, you think that we should shoot him in the back and let Michael dismember him? And he's like, yeah. And Harry pauses for a second and then just goes, okay.
And that happens after he comes flying back, right?
No, that's before.
Is that before?
Yeah, he drops out of sight and then he comes back and is flying because he drops out of sight. Michael... Marcone is like, I think I got him pretty well. And Harry's like, I really don't think he can be killed at all. And Marcone says, okay, interesting. Do you think that he can run as fast as a train? And Harry's like, probably. And then a moment later, I was wrong. He didn't run as fast as the train. He flew. So this asshole is he just won't fucking die. He's like Jason Voorhees. It's so annoying, frankly, yeah. is what it is. Less than being like just straight up terrifying. It's just, you know, come on. It's rude. We have done plenty. Just give us our thing. But yeah. And finally, because his daughter jumps in with her hair.
Oh, yeah. Sanya gets taken down, you know. And I had forgotten that he broke his arm earlier. Mm-hmm. So he ends up going down. And then I think Nicodemus steps on his, I don't know if it's his good arm or his bad arm.
Oh, and that's right. Because he uncouples the cars.
Oh, that's right. That happens, too. And yep. they have to, like, jump to, you know, get onto the car that's still on the train. Harry just barely makes it.
Right.
He has to cheat a little.
He uses Forzari, and then it pushes him too close, and he's like, oh, shit, when he lands. So, hey, yeah, this is when Harry says, why are you doing this? But why the plague? And he says, the apocalypse, as you refer to it, isn't an event. It isn't any specific event. One day, I'm sure, there will be an apocalypse that really does bring on the end, but I doubt it will be this event that begins it. Apocalypse is a frame of mind, a belief, a surrender to inevitability. It is a despair for the future. It is the death of hope. And then Michael says, and in that kind of environment, there's more suffering, more pain, more desperation, more power to the underworld and their servants.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Nicodemus has this all figured out because he's already got some group that's going to take credit mm-hmm. for the plague. And then that's going to incite all kinds of other shit. And he's like, yeah, this is all part of the process.
Yep.
This is the way it goes. This is simple entropy, which is a bummer.
Right? Things fall apart. Why do you stand against me? Your resistance to it is pointless. Which, like, man has a point a little bit,
but a Michael's little. There with the faith.
Yep.
Pulls out the sword. Nicodemus is like, in response to the question, he pulls out the sword and Nicodemus is like, eloquent.
So they get in that fight and then Harry winds up throwing Michael the other sword. And he does that cleanse what is unclean, oh God.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael is starting to drive back Nicodemus with the sword, and Nicodemus can tell that he might lose, and so he draws a gun.
He draws a fucking gun.
Fucking this cheaters left and right hide these guns. I swear to God.
I mean, granted, Nicodemus didn't agree to any kind of accords or anything, but still, it's the principle.
Yep. He shoved it against Michael's breastplate and pulled the trigger repeatedly.
Yeah.
Did you think he had died?
Not in my heart, no.
Okay.
No. That could have just been denial, though, because I really don't know where we're going. I just want Michael to be a part of the series, even mm-hmm. though I realize the more attached I get to him, the more likely that something will happen to him. But I really don't want that.
That's so fair.
I'm going to probably, every time something like this happens, I'm probably just going to be like, nope, he's not dead. He's fine.
Right.
It's going to be fine. I don't know how yet, but it's going to be fine. Especially since Shiro had just died. It just seemed like too much.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But they sure didn't make you fucking wait.
No. they're mean about it. I say they're like there's like six people working on this book. So he goes down. Harry tries to keep shooting. Nicodemus is just disdainful of the fucking bullets. Like, really?
Yeah.
Harry's like, don't offer me another coin. And he's like, yeah, I'm done with that part.
And then offers him. I loved it.
What'd you think?
I loved it.
Did you think Marcone would take it?
Nah. But I just love this whole exchange.
Yeah.
I love it. And because he just says, I heard about you. Are you interested in a job? And Marcone says, I was just going to ask you the same thing. It's so good. I laughed so hard at that. Oh, I needed a break in attention, guys. This has been like, you know, there's a lot happening.
Mm-hmm.
So that was good. And then he's like, Nicodemus is like, all right, well, I have to kill you. But, you know, but I understand.
Oh, man.
And meanwhile, Marcone and Harry had been like exchanging these looks.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were ready in a way that surprised me. I didn't. Because this basically turned into sort of like a physical attack.
Yeah.
You know, Harry with his staff, fucking Marcone with a knife. It's so up close, you know. It's very different from like a fancy sword fighting, you know, or magic. They're like rumbling. It was very unexpected.
Yeah. That Marcone makes Nicodemus flinch because he throws a knife at his face. Mm-hmm. As he flinches, Harry like grabs at his gun arm and traps it. Then Marcone goes after him with another knife because Marcone is the man who carries multiple knives.
Yes, he is.
And he cuts the shroud in half, which takes it off of Nicodemus, which ends the curse. Which, that's a blow.
Yeah, yeah. Also, real quick, earlier on, when they're fucking, my God, when is it? Is it when they first get on the train? And Marcone wants, and they have like, it's the first guys that I guess Michael and Xania dealt with on the train. The first goons.
Okay.
And then Marcone is like, all right, we're going to kill him, right? And they're like, no.
Oh, right.
But he has handcuffs in his utility belt.
I love it. Marcone's just like, are you serious? Like, I can just imagine him being like so annoyed because he's the one in charge usually.
He's so annoyed. And he's like really annoyed with their level of incompetence. Like, this is not professional. You mm-hmm. kill them. This is not how you do business.
Yep.
Fucking amateurs.
I feel like I have an affinity for Marcone at times that worries me. Not gonna lie. Deirdre leaps at Marcone because he's got the shroud now. And Marcone jumps and like lands in the river.
Yeah, he just fucking bounces, takes the shroud, hits the water feet first, and he's out.
And then Nicodemus grabs Harry and is about to try and like put him in a chokehold. And Harry all of a sudden realizes that, oh my God, mm-hmm. I bet that noose is the only thing that can actually hurt him because it's the one thing that's keeping him from getting hurt.
Right.
So he reaches back and he yanks on it. And he says, Nicodemus reacted in sudden and obvious panic. Which, what a great moment.
Yeah, no shit, right?
Seeing him panic. Oh, bless.
I love this turn, too, with the idea that the noose is the one thing that he's vulnerable to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's got that sort of symmetry that I like sometimes with things.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry hears Shiro's voice. He's afraid of you.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says something. He says he, in his memories, he watched Nicodemus edge away from Shiro as the old man entered the room. The noose made him invulnerable to any lasting harm, but in a flash of insight, I was able to bet. And I just like love that sort of, it doesn't hold our hand to how Harry makes the connection.
Right.
But it does feel like you're watching it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I always like that.
Agreed.
When you feel like you're getting to it with them, you know?
Yep. Yeah, no, I totally agree. So Harry basically uses the noose to throw Nicodemus off the train, except that Deirdre catches him.
Ah, this fucking girl.
I hate her so much.
She
frankly
stays in the way. They should have took her head off.
So then Nicodemus is yelling at her to kill Harry. And Harry grabs Michael and jumps off the train, too. Which, you know, I guess.
Yeah, I mean,
what else I guess it's your best option.
What else are you going to do?
So he's sinking. Keep in mind, Michael's covered in fucking armor.
Oh my God, that's right.
And then he feels something in the water, and he's holds on to it. And
I got really nervous here.
Did you think that it was Deirdre or somebody saving him?
I thought it was like he said he felt like somebody hit through a rope, and I was like, if he's holding on to this fucking noose, I am going to throw this book across the
room. That'd be messed up.
Or if it's one of her tendrils or something. But luckily, it is Marcone with the shroud that is surprisingly durable.
Yeah, that shit just it was able to be sliced by his knife, but Harry and Michael's weight on it, no big deal.
Mm-hmm. No big deal. It's all wet and shit still. No big deal. And that's like the first thing that Harry thinks about when he's waking up is that it should have torn.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that there's no time to go about it, but I feel like that little spark is going to be some kind of faith that Harry needs at some point.
It's interesting, though. I think I read somewhere. Oh, no. You know what it is? Or wait. Is that it? Wait, did we watch something recently where somebody uses wet fabric because it's stronger than dry fabric?
I don't think so.
I'm wondering if that was if it was justified. There was something I think I covered for the podcast, but it might not have been. And the guy ties like some rags around these prison bars, inserts a piece of scrap metal into the fabric, and then pisses on the fabric and begins to twist the bar so that the fabric tightens and tightens and tightens. And because it's been pissed on and it's wet, the fabric is somehow stronger than it would be otherwise. And twisting this bar that's like a lever pulls the bars together and creates a bigger opening for him to reach his arm through.
That sounds like a bunch of poppycock.
I'm looking at this because I can't remember what the fuck I saw this in.
I can't remember the last time I watched something where somebody was like behind, needed to reach through bars or something for anything.
Is wet fabric stronger? Moisture penetrating molecules can act as a lubricant and result in loss of strength. Oh, cotton fiber cellulose. Therefore, cotton cellulose does not lose strength when wet like rayon does. In fact, it gets stronger. Mm. Synthetic fibers are hydrophobic. Therefore, their strength is not affected at all by moisture.
How about that? So for cotton, yes. Rayon, no.
Yeah.
And then your synthetic fabrics.
Wool and viscose show loss in strength in a wet state. Of all natural fibers, cotton fiber or fabric shows higher strength in a wet state.
Hmm.
Yeah, so that's interesting.
Well, I guess the shroud would be cotton.
Or linen.
Hmm. Can I tell you a secret?
What?
I don't really know what linen is. I mean, I know what it is, right?
Yeah.
But I don't know what it is. Like, someone says silk, I know where silk comes from. Cotton, I know where cotton comes from. Don't know anything about linen.
Linen comes from flax.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. And this says linen is one of the few fabrics that gets stronger when wet.
Mm.
So linen and cotton. Yeah, both of them.
Well, that was an interesting little turn we took.
Right? Just like, how about that? So let me see. Is the Shroud of Turin made of linen? Oh my God. I started to write, is the Shroud of Turin linen? And it wrote, is the Shroud of Turin linked to disasters?
Holy shit. backspace.
That's not what I wanted to know.
I'm going to low-key look that up later than when we're done recording.
It looks like the Shroud is linen, is cotton.
Okay. All right. Well, then this story holds up.
Oh, it says linen and cotton.
Oh shit,
okay.
Twist.
Good God, there's too much happening. It's a Shroud of Turin linked to... Okay, well, I want to look that up, but I will later.
I'm going to look up later, too.
Restrain myself a little bit. Okay, so Harry wakes up, and he's at Michael's place. And he is, Murphy is standing over him. Sanya's there. He says something about the shroud, falls asleep again, and then he wakes up in the morgue. This by itself is really enough to ruin your day, which I enjoy. And Butters is there, and Harry starts, like, shrieking that he's not dead.
That's my favorite part.
But, Gene Murphy's like, yeah, dude, we know. It's chill out. Chill the fuck out.
And poor Butters is like, yeah, the x-ray is a mess. Mm-hmm. And it's just because Harry is fucking it up. Just his presence. Fucking the x-ray machine up.
Right.
But, they get him taken care of. And, you know, I don't know. I knew when he attacks Nicodemus and he grabs the gun hand, the gun goes off because it says that there's like a bright flash and a loud bang. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't sure where Harry got shot.
Ah.
But it turns out to be, it looks like a shoulder wound.
Mm-hmm.
So, considering that he just got shot, that he's able to grab Michael, you know, at all. Because Michael's big. And like you mentioned, wearing a bunch of fucking armor.
Yeah, he is.
It's pretty impressive, considering that we know our Harry is not like a big strapping dude, you know.
Right. Yeah. It's maybe not the most realistic that he didn't just sink like a stone, but you know, it's fine. So then when Harry wakes up finally again, he is in the guest room at the Carpenter's place, and there's a little kid there, Harry Carpenter. He says, I'm Harry. Howie. Good enough, kid.
And this is when we finally find out that Michael is not dead.
And it turns out that his wife makes the armor that he wears because she used to work on motorcycles.
I love that little detail.
Is that the raddest thing ever?
It really is. I want a whole charity backstory at some point.
Mm-hmm.
But, and she has sewn several layers of bulletproof fabric and ceramic strike pleats because she is not a fool.
Yep. She said she wasn't going to spend all that trouble making the breastplate and then have me get killed with a gun.
Right. And yep. It's funny, I don't know why that wouldn't have come up earlier other than just as a way to tell the story.
Mm-hmm.
Because Michael has this little joking kind of thing with Sanya where they're talking. Because Sanya's wearing like a straight up bulletproof vest.
Right.
And he goes back and forth about like, you know, his old fashioned. And he says then, well, that his faith protects him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he could have just been like, well, yeah, I've got some shit going on underneath though, so I'm fine.
Right.
And I don't know if that's, I mean, I know it's for effect and it's, you know, so we can have this moment,
mm-hmm.
but I'm just like, why would Michael just say?
Do you know what I like to think with this is that Michael is just in his head, this conversation with Harry and Sanya is just a repeat of a conversation he already had with Charity. And that's what he said to Charity. He said, my faith protects me. And Charity's like, yeah, fuck you. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to do it. And he's just like saying it to them with that little smile on his face because he remembers the conversation that he had with her where that was what he said. And she like bit his head off.
I like to
that's completely fabricated. But
that he doesn't know she's done it.
Ah.
So that he can honestly just be like, well, my faith protects me. Because he's willing to go out with just the chainmail. But meanwhile, she's like, look, no.
I could go with that, too. I like that. I like the idea that he, like, puts on his armor and he sees this, like, little attachment, like, buckle that he didn't know, like, he's never used before, and he touches it, and, like, a friggin', like, rocket launcher suddenly appears.
He's like Inspector Gadget.
Yep, like, he's got some weird, like, steampunk shit happening.
He's got all kinds of new attachments and shit from Charity. She's like Alfred.
I would love that. Oh, That'd be so great. So it turns out that Sonia's also fine. Marcone was the one who called up Murphy and told her about everything, like where they were and everything.
Mm-hmm.
The whole crew of the train was murdered. And the three goons that they had caught killed themselves. So they didn't kill them, but they're dead anyway.
Yeah, but they're dead anyway. Which is, they took suicide pills,
mm-hmm.
but I'm like, it's not like they could talk. Like,
I mean, <you know? laughs> I guess not, but there's probably, I mean, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, but Marcone had said, or was it Marcone? When he was trying to convince them to let him kill them,
mm-hmm.
He says, you know, that they're fanatics. So
true.
You know, so once they failed, you know, it makes sense that they would just... Plus, they're walking around with fucking suicide pellets, so
yeah.
It's kind of understood that that's what you're going to do.
Oh, that is such a crazy thing. And then Murphy takes them to Butters because a gunshot wound has to be reported to the cops. So they can't have Harry being looked at in the emergency room. Mm-hmm. Plus, you know, having Harry in a hospital is always dangerous. It's just kind of an iffy thing. So, and then Murphy brings up Shiro and is like, hey, I saw a body at the airport. Did you know who that was? And he's like, yeah, I sure did.
Yeah.
And that was supposed to be me.
Yeah, she's like, did they get away? And he's like, I got away. I don't think I did much more than annoy them.
Yeah,
yeah. So this is done, and the shroud is, you know, taken away from them, and the plague is stopped. Mm-hmm. But they're still totally out there.
Yeah, they are.
And she's like, well, what happens if they come back? And I was like, that's a good fucking question, Carolyn. Right.
Yes, it is. Oh, and there's the detail about Rudolph, too, who got promoted to internal affairs.
Which, I'm glad that he's out of her hair, but I feel like that's a worse place for him to be.
Probably.
Because he's going to be all up in everybody's business, and he can't be trusted, and he's such a snake. Maybe that means he'll be written out of the story, though. I feel no.
He calls him Rudolph the brown-nosed reindeer. So this is when Harry gets the letter that Shiro sent him. And Shiro tells him that he was terminal. And also, kind of almost like a... he basically says, we have it a little bit easier than you do.
Yeah.
In some ways. Because we know always what's right and what is wrong and what our job is. Yeah. And you don't have that luxury.
Yeah. And it's very compassionate.
Right? I like that.
It's not, you would think that someone in Shiro's position would be so much more judgmental. Or he could be, you know, so much more judgmental of someone like Harry. Mm-hmm. But on the flip side, I think because of his position and who he is and his faith and all that kind of stuff, it makes him really generous. Mm-hmm. When he's dealing with Harry, he has a lot of patience for Harry.
Yeah.
And, you know, he tells him here that he's a decent man. You're good and you're good enough. God lives in hearts like yours.
Yeah.
Which is a really wonderful, beautiful thing to say to someone. You know?
Yeah, it is.
And it's just a really decent thing. And I feel like it just would have made Harry feel even worse.
Right.
You know, someone this kind and generous is like, you know, even with the reveal that it turns out he was dying anyway, so don't feel sad for me, you know, and I'm at peace and all that kind of stuff. But it just, mm-hmm. it was such a nice thing to tell Harry. And with the way this ended, I think it was very timely.
Oh, man. I feel like I just really like Shiro. It's a shame,
too.
You know?
Yeah, I really did, too.
We needed you, guy.
Yeah. Plus, he was funny. He had a couple of really good lines.
Yeah, he did. and his story about becoming a Baptist.
Yeah,
that's a good one.
So, but that does mean that there is room now on the team. So I'm really curious how that's going to happen and who it will be. Will it be someone we know that we are surprised to see again? Will it be a whole new person? Will it be Harry?
Harry sure doesn't fucking seem to think so.
So, yeah, and then and Michael and Sanya had no idea.
Right.
About Shiro being sick. But then it all makes sense to them once they get this bit of news.
Yeah. Yeah, and it really does make sense in retrospect, too, because it was mostly Sanya and Michael who kept telling Harry not to get involved.
Mm-hmm.
And Shiro was the one that would kind of hang back and let them do the talking. And, you know, now they realize that Shiro knew they needed Harry,
mm-hmm.
but they couldn't go about it in the normal way with just being like, yeah, get up in on this because the Barabbas curse and whatnot, you know. So Harry gets a call from the dry cleaners also.
Oh, this was a nice little way to end it.
Yeah, it turns out that Anna Valmont left the pockets of the keys to the Blue Beetle in the left the keys in the pocket. I said the pockets of the keys.
I was like, what is happening?
I had a small stroke. It's no big deal. And she wrote thank you on the back of the bill to the parking garage where the beetle is sitting, which I thought was kind of adorable. She returned everything. I mean, that's way more than one would expect.
Yeah. And I had kind of forgotten about her. I'm not going to lie. So this was a really nice little surprise. And then he gets home and he's got a postcard from Rio. Mm-hmm. And we know that it's Susan immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And he catches her up to speed. And they have sort of a sad goodbye.
Yeah.
She tells him that Ortega is back in this town where they are.
Mm-hmm.
He realizes that he's getting sued from the Larry...
Oh, my God. The Larry Fowler show.
Which I don't even know. Well, it doesn't matter.
I mean, she says he can't prove that, right? Oh, and also she says that because, you know, Martin made it sound like she totally knew what they were up to. But she tells Harry, I didn't know. He wouldn't tell me the whole, like, I knew that we were coming up here for some secret mission, but I didn't know that was, there was, like, that whole thing.
Yeah, she didn't know that they were there to kill Ortega. And she says, basically, that Martin used her to cover his plans, which is kind of shitty.
Yeah.
And it makes sense later when she says she doesn't want to become like Martin.
Mm-hmm.
Shut off from everyone and everything.
Yeah.
And then Harry mentions right before that, oh, well, the Ortega is coming to kill Harry personally. So there's that.
Right.
Let's not forget about that.
Yeah. Then there's, like you said, the sad goodbye. I love you. And he just says, me too. And if you ever need my help, get in touch. And he says, only if I need your help. And she says, yeah. And he hangs up. He falls asleep. And then when he wakes up, it's Ebenezer just saying, you should watch the news, click. What did you think of this?
I had no idea what this was.
No? Oh, my God, girl. Then that explains part of what you just said. Because Harry goes to a diner so that he can watch the news on their TV.
Well, a giant asteroid has hit the village of where Ortega is.
They thought it was an asteroid. It turns out that it was actually a deactivated Soviet communications satellite, which decayed in orbit and fell to Earth.
Right.
Remember satellite Dresden? Harry and Ebenezer talk about this in the beginning of the book. They found a satellite, and Ebenezer asks Harry, do you remember where we put that thing? Remember when we used to stargaze and we saw that fall?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I knew I got that it was a connection. I got that Ebenezer is responsible for what has happened here. Mm-hmm. But I could not put it together. Like,
yep. Asteroid Dresden. Sorry, not satellite Dresden. Asteroid Dresden. And it fell on Paolo Ortega. It took out the whole mess, basically. I'm trying to find, let's see, impacted just outside the village of Casa Verde in Honduras. However, information coming in from agencies around the world indicates that the so-called meteor was in actuality a deactivated Soviet communication satellite which decayed in orbit and fell to Earth. No estimates on the number of deaths or injuries in this tragic freak accident have yet reached authorities, but it seems unlikely that anyone in the manor house could possibly have survived the impact. So, Ebenezer went full on, like, Old Testament.
I think that I couldn't figure out, like, and this is going to sound really stupid. I couldn't figure out. I was like, could Ebenezer do that?
I mean.
But I guess he can.
Harry has said that the people on the White Council can do things that just.
Right. I guess I really had not expanded my imagination to be ready for this. And then because he says, I made a mental note to myself to never get on Ebenezer's bad side.
Yep. Yeah.
So, okay.
Yeah, this guy is not fucking around. So, yeah, so that's that. And then the last thing, Marcone. Well, not the last, second to last. Harry follows him and he goes to this long-term care therapeutic facility, to a private hospital in Wisconsin. It's this, like, Harry hangs out and watches him through the window go into this girl's room. She's in a bed that's clearly not been moved around in. Mm-hmm. She's obviously in a coma.
Yeah, she's in as a Jane Doe.
Mm-hmm. And Marcone comes in and he reads to her for a while and then he covers her with the shroud and tucks it in around her and prays.
Yeah. This was really sad.
Yeah, it was.
And the way he's described, you know, he waited for an hour, his face sunken and tired.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like, we usually don't. And he has this teddy bear he pulls out of his backpack,
yeah,
to lay down with her while he's, you know, doing all this. And then
I saw him forming the word please over,
yeah,
and over.
It's so sad.
Yeah.
And then he takes the teddy bear back and puts it back in his backpack. And Harry's just waiting for him outside at the car.
Mm-hmm.
And it took a lot of work for Harry to find him. Like, it was, yeah, tricky to tail him because Marcone knows how to lose people. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, there was, like, magic that, what does he say? There was a...
Let's see, I'm trying to find... It wasn't easy. I had to call in a couple of favors in the spirit world to get a beacon spell going on him, and he knew all the tricks for losing a tail. I had to borrow Michael's truck so that I could have a prayer of following him inconspicuously. He changed cars twice and somehow called into effect the magical equivalent of a destructive electromagnetic pulse that scrambled my beacon spell. Yeah. Yeah.
So he confronts him and Harry's like, you got to give me the shroud, dude.
Yeah.
And he's like, nope, I just got it here.
Mm-hmm.
Harry wants to know who the girl is. Marcone is not going to tell him.
Mm-hmm.
And so then Harry tries to threaten him. Give it to me or I'm going to call the police. And then Marcone responds to that, you know, just like, you can't do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he says she'd be in danger. And Harry says, she's yours. And instead of answering, Marcone, mm-hmm, just says, I'll kill you. If you so much as breathe in her direction, I'll kill you, Dresden, myself.
I believed, yeah, him.
Right?
So Harry kind of switches the tone of the conversation.
Yeah, he takes a different tack.
And what he ends up doing is saying he's going to give him 3 days. Mm-hmm. Because 3 days is a magic number.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also how long Christ is supposed to have been wrapped in it. If it's going to work, that's how it's going to work and when it's going to work.
Right.
And then he says, if it doesn't work, just ship it to Father Fort Hill.
No note, no nothing.
Yeah. And we don't know if he's going, like, what's going to happen with this.
Right.
I mean, I didn't expect a cure.
Okay.
And we don't, we know that the shroud gets returned in 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
We don't really know if it worked or not, but I feel like it didn't work.
Doesn't seem to have, no.
Yeah. I mean, because if it worked, he would still return it, right? He doesn't need it anymore if it worked.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but I feel like no.
And also he like says, oh, so if I don't do this, you'll expose her. And Harry says, no, I won't do that. I'll take it up with you.
I love that too.
And Mark, he stared at me for a long moment before his expression softened. All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like this. And there's Harry goes on to kind of talk about Marcone a little bit, about how he can't hate him anymore.
Mm-hmm.
He's still a bad guy. He calls him a black hat. You know, he does still cause pain and suffering through his business. You know, he peddles in human misery and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But Harry starts to think maybe he's been doing all of this for a noble reason.
Right.
And he says that I just couldn't hate him anymore because I wasn't sure I would have made the same choice in his place.
Yeah.
So this is nice.
Yeah.
You know. I mean, they have always had kind of a, Marcone and Dresden have had sort of a grudging respect for each other.
I ship them.
I do too.
Just a little bit.
This latest adventure, I mean, I don't expect Marcone to suddenly not be a bad guy anymore, and it doesn't sound like Harry does either. But I like the sort of understanding and kind of respect. And now they have a thing that they've been through together.
Yeah.
I mean, giant dog, cat, boar things chased after
them.
They
did have the Loup Garou together, too, though.
That is true.
Where Marcone was spinning, hanging upside down, and had a knife in his mouth. What was it? Like, he was a maniac. Fucking.
I want him to have his own book or size 32.
Oh, true.
So then this kind of ends with, like, a sort of a cookout party at Michael's house to say goodbye to Sonia, who's going back to Europe, and there's everybody's hanging out, there's lots of food. Molly is somehow having Sonia do crank calls, but he doesn't seem to understand what he's doing.
He does not realize that Prince Albert in a can is an old joke.
He seems perplexed that people keep hanging up on him.
Right.
And then everything takes a turn. Harry's in the backyard with the baby, does something which I think is super human, which is just to go after something a kid is leaning towards because you don't know what it is and you don't want them to get their hands on it.
Mm-hmm.
And you very rarely ever even look at the thing you're going for because it's just so instinctual.
Yeah.
And he does that, and it's a motherfucking coin.
Yeah, it is.
And then this motherfucker slow drives up the street like he's about to, like, do a drive-by or something with the window rolled down.
Be seeing you, Justin.
Like, when he says that, he's got, like, lowrider, like, a fucking bandana on his head. He's wearing khakis and shit.
Oh, my God. Wouldn't it be amazing if he, fuck, if his car was, like, on,
oh, it's on hydraulics and shit.
Be seeing you, Dresden. And in the distance, gasolina. Oh, God.
Oh, I want a picture of that. I want a fucking Nicodemus Cholo style.
Oh, I love that so much. And I love, too, how he says, I had the sudden intangible impression that someone nearby was waking up from a nap and stretching.
Mm. That was really creepy.
Right? He keeps hearing some whispering, and he has to drown it out with off-key singing in the car.
Yeah. I like, too, there's a moment where Sonya comes out because he smells it. And then he just is like, oh, it's the baby.
I forgot about that. You're stinky. So, Harry goes home and John Wick style buries a coin in the cement in his basement.
I hope that two buckets of cement is going to be enough. It says the whispering cuts off as soon as he does it.
He also puts a steel ring around it and wills energy into it. So, like, he's got it in a magic circle plus concrete. Like,
yeah, I still, it's, I mean, they were so insistent that he shouldn't even touch it.
Yep.
I mean, but it feels like he's got this under control, but I don't like that he doesn't tell anybody. He sneaks out of the party after he touches this coin. He doesn't say goodbye to anybody, which is probably the best thing to do. Well, no, I take that back. Well, let me see. If he had told Michael and them, they would have made a whole big deal of it.
Probably.
That's what he wanted to avoid. So, I mean, I'm glad that he buries it. It seems like it's safe, even though I know it's not. But I don't know what they would have done. They would have made him give it to him. Michael would have made Harry give him the coin. But then what does Michael do after Harry's touched it? Like, I don't even know what the process is. Do you rush him to the church? Like, what do you... Yeah, see, I don't know enough about it. I'm wondering, like, what would Michael have done if Harry had said, oh my God, Michael, I touched the coin. They take it, they wrap it up, and then what do they do with Harry?
What do you think?
Fuck. I don't know, because Harry hasn't accepted anything, you know, or fallen, so he doesn't have to do the thing where he makes a choice to separate from him, like, you know, we've seen them do with the other Daenerians.
Right.
But they don't talk about if there's anything, I don't know, go take him to church and dump him in holy water? I don't know. I mean, Harry seems like he has it covered, but I know that he doesn't.
I'm something like a Denarian. I don't think holy water is going to do the job. Right? If one of the holy swords cutting through him wouldn't even kill him.
See, that's what I mean, though. Since Harry isn't in league with it, he hasn't accepted it yet, right?
Right.
So
it's not, the coin is not buried in the flesh of his forehead.
Yes. It's just buried in the basement of his apartment. But, so I don't know if really anything needs to be done as long as Harry isn't tempted by it. And it seems like the temptation is the voice that, you know, whispers to you, right? Mm-hmm. And if he can't hear the voice, then he should be good. But I know that that's not true. All right, I guess I'll see. I didn't care for an ending like this. I'm just going to be honest.
Yeah, this was distressing to me. And I'm not going to lie to you. It is really, like, none of this is going to go the way you think it's going to go. I'll just say that.
Well, that could be good or bad.
It is all kinds of surprises. But I will be very interested to see what you think of how this is handled. All right. Well, so I had mentioned to you how I wanted to do some between stories before we started the next book.
Mm-hmm.
The next book is Blood Rites. So there's a couple of different... like collections of short stories. There's one that's called Briefcases, which I think is not out yet. Yeah, that comes out June 5th. But Side Jobs is the audiobook that I have, and Working with Bigfoot is the other one. Two of those stories come before Blood Rites begins. There's also one called Vignette, but it is like a vignette. It's like, you know, a page. It's not even a full story. It's just a little moment. So I think I probably can, I think I can find those on his website, 'cause he has a lot of his shorts for free to read on his website.
Okay.
And I will look into that. If not, I'm going to give you my password to my audiobooks so that you can listen to them. So Restoration of Faith, which that one technically takes place before the first book. And it's like one of the very first cases that Harry ever works. And the next one is B is for Bigfoot. And that one comes after Full Moon. And I found that one to be kind of delightful. Mm-hmm. I really enjoyed B is for Bigfoot. Restoration of Faith is clunky. It's like the original Dresden story that he wrote in school for like a project that gave him the idea for Harry Dresden as a character in the Dresden Files series. And you can see the seams in it, you know?
Okay.
But it's still interesting because of like how raw it is. And B is for Bigfoot is just its own whole little side world that we don't really see in the books at all. So it's really a whole new bit of lore, which is really fun.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, just for all of you out there who are following along with us, you should go and check those out. So once again, it's Restoration of Faith and B is for Bigfoot. Restoration of Faith is in the collection called Side Jobs, and B is for Bigfoot is in the collection called Working with Bigfoot, or Working for Bigfoot. I think it's for Bigfoot. yeah, so.
Oh, God. I just got a really funny picture of Bigfoot hiring Harry because he thinks that people are in the woods always, like, chasing after him, trying to take his picture. But nobody believes him that they exist, so he hires Harry to prove it.
Oh, I love that idea. That's so wonderful. All right. And then just real quick, want to say hi to new patrons. This week we have Jessica, Taylor Snellenberger, which is like the namiest name, Snellenberger, Melissa Coons, and Ashley Monetzi. Welcome to all of you. A couple of you are at $10 and above, so you will be getting patron postcards for the month of March. And I just ordered those, and they're kind of fun. They are loosely themed on St. Patrick's Day. And, yeah, I think that was all I wanted to mention this time around. Is there anything you'd like to add, madam?
No, ma'am. I'm just looking forward to the little side stories and then getting back into the books because I'm really curious about how things are going to be now.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it is. Yeah. Yeah. I have all kinds of things to, like, ready to talk about when we get to some of that stuff because it's a really interesting concept. You know what? I know what it was. This is what I meant to say, that I knew I was forgetting something. Megan Tolentino, she formerly, I feel like, I can't remember her original last name, but she got married and her name changed. Megan is my, like, probably number one very first supporter. She's the OG. She donated first. Like when we did our very, very first fundraiser when the website got hacked back in 2013. And every time I do any fundraiser or do anything, she's like the first one. And she's like, yep, here's my money. Here's my support. I'm sharing your things. I'm talking about you. Like she's always just on it. And she recently upped her pledge. Because if you do a $30 pledge, you get a little plug on whatever show, whichever of the shows I cover that you want so that you can choose whatever audience you think is going to be the most receptive to whatever you're trying to plug. So Megan has this project coming up and she has given me some copy to read. And this sounds really fun. And I actually think I'm going to check this out. She says, when you're through with the books and short stories, and after you've convinced yourself the TV show isn't worth your time, hint, she's right. Odds are you'll still be hungry for more Dresden. The tabletop role-playing game, Dresden Accelerated, offers a quick and easy way to experience your own adventure in the world of Harry Dresden. To hear what it's like to create your own stories, check out the campaign Friends Like These from the Redacted Files podcast. Listen as a questionable collection of heroes find themselves hunted by merciless foes wielding the hideous powers of fey hordes, ghoulish monstrosities, and CrossFit enthusiasts. Terrifying stuff, Megan. Search for the Redacted Files in your podcatcher of choice or visit theredactedfiles.com. And she warns major spoilers through White Knight, minor spoilers through Cold Day. So, everybody, you should check that out. Megan is rad. She's super just, like, on her shit. And she has been, I think, podcasting almost as long as I have at this point, because I think that she's had, she had another show as well. But yeah, I really think y'all should check that out. So it's the redactedfiles.com, and the name of the campaign is Friends Like These. So yeah, please show her some love.
That sounds and if you're cool. interested,
doesn't that sound cool?
I can't and, like, go anywhere near it, but it sounds cool as
you
fuck.
Can't. But it's something that's going to be going on for until like late March or mid March, March 11th. It's going to be 3 episodes long, and yeah, I just think that that's a really cool idea, because the Dresden Files RPG is something that I've been really curious about. RPG games can be hard for me to get into, and with Dresden giving me, like, the, you know, leg up with knowing all the characters already, I feel like it would be a lot easier for me to get into that concept.
Mm-hmm.
So I am definitely going to check this out, because I would kind of like to be able, I think a lot of Owen's friends have read the Dresden Files, so this is a potential game that we could play together that I wouldn't be bored stiff by. So yeah, guys, check that out. And if you're interested also in, getting some project of yours plugged on the show, become a patron for $30 and boom, I'll do it. I'll plug it. You can either give me copy that you would like me to read the way that Megan did, or you can just tell me, like, the broad strokes of your project and I can wing it. Or you can, if you are a podcast, if that's the project you're plugging and you like are familiar with doing recordings, you can record a blurb and I can cut that into the show, whatever way you want to do it. But yeah, Megan, thank you so much for supporting me so that I can support you back, because that's rad.
That's
I like
how it
being
works.
Able to do this, you know, it really is. So I think that's everything. And I'm so glad that I remembered, because if we hung
too.
Up and I had forgot, I would be so fucking mad at myself. all right, everybody, theredactedfiles.com. And we will see you next week with 2 short stories. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.